And after 2 or 3 days of the neuropsych testing, the doctor pulled me aside and she said, this is definitely Alzheimer's disease. So he was officially diagnosed with early-onset Alzheimer's at the age of 36 in April of 2001. Some of the biggest challenges that I face every day is the unpredictability. The disease is unpredictable. My husband could be fine 1 minute, the next he could have a fever. One day he woke up, he was fine. The next day he woke up with a punctured lung. We had to rush him to the hospital.
Welcome everyone to Family Comes First. I'm Vincent J. Russo.
And I'm Victoria Roberts Drogin. Thank you for joining us today. According to recent estimates, as many as 5.3 million Americans have Alzheimer's disease. It is the seventh leading cause of death for Americans. Here's a brief video on how Alzheimer's affects the brain. Let's take a look.
What is Alzheimer's disease? Alzheimer's is a slow, fatal disease of the brain affecting 1 in 10 people over the age of 65. No one is immune. The disease comes on gradually as two abnormal protein fragments called plaques and tangles accumulate in the brain and kill brain cells. They start here in the hippocampus, the part of the brain where memories are first formed. Over many years' time, the plaques and tangles slowly destroy the hippocampus, and it becomes harder and harder to form new memories. Simple recollections from a few hours or days ago that the rest of us might take for granted are just not there. After that, more plaques and tangles spread into different regions of the brain, killing cells and compromising function wherever they go. This spreading around is what causes the different stages of Alzheimer's. From the hippocampus, the disease spreads here to the region of the brain where language is processed. When that happens, it gets tougher and tougher to find the right word. Next, the disease creeps toward the front of the brain where logical thought takes place. Very gradually, a person begins to lose the ability to solve problems, grasp concepts, and make plans. Next, the plaques and tangles invade the part of the brain where emotions are regulated. When this happens, the patient gradually loses control over moods and feelings. After that, the disease moves to where the brain makes sense of things it sees, hears, and smells. In this stage, Alzheimer's wreaks havoc on a person's senses and can spark hallucinations. Eventually, the plaques and tangles erase a person's oldest and most precious memories, which are stored here in the back of the brain. Near the end, the disease compromises a person's balance and coordination. And in the very last stage, it destroys the part of the brain that regulates breathing and the heart. The progression from mild forgetting to death is slow and steady, and takes place over an average of 8 to 10 years. It is relentless and, for now, incurable. Helping your family, friends, and neighbors to better understand Alzheimer's will reduce stigma, improve care, and even help the fight for a cure. Thanks for helping to do your part.
As you can see in that video, we know that Alzheimer's disease affects seniors, but what is most shocking is that it also affects people under the age of 65. This is very alarming. There are over 250,000 Americans with Alzheimer's disease under the age of 65.
Vincent, I understand that this is referred to as early onset Alzheimer's disease. It seems impossible, but a recent report by the Alzheimer's Association has estimated that 10 million baby boomers are projected to have Alzheimer's disease, and that the number of people under age 65 with Alzheimer's continues to increase.
Victoria, I cannot fathom how these families are coping. Today we will meet a most remarkable family, the Henley family. Mike was diagnosed with early onset familial Alzheimer's disease at age 36. His wife, Karen, and two children, Courtney and Brandon, have become his caregivers for the past 9 years. And what's more frightening is that both Courtney and Brandon have a 50-50 chance of inheriting that gene that causes familial Alzheimer's disease.
It's a challenge that I cannot imagine, Vincent. Mm. And the family we will meet today is truly inspiring. But first, we are going to provide you with information and resources that can help if you have a family member with Alzheimer's or even suspect that they may have Alzheimer's.
We are privileged to have Mary Ann Ragona, the Executive Director of the Alzheimer's Association Long Island Chapter, and Dr. Irving Gomelin, the Chief of Geriatric Medicine and Clinical Pharmacology at Winthrop University Hospital. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you.
Pleasure to be here.
And Mary Ann, you're welcome back.
Thank you.
Yeah, this is your second time on Family Comes First.
Repeat performance.
And Doctor, thank you so much for taking time out of your very busy schedule. Much appreciated. We're going to start with Mary Ann with a very simple question. I'm 56 years old. I see these statistics. It's frightening. What is going on? So many people being diagnosed with Alzheimer's under the age of 65.
Sadly, Vincent, we don't really have an answer. I wish we did. This is a new dynamics in the world of Alzheimer's disease. It's been steadily increasing probably for the last 2 to 3 years. As you said earlier, the National Association indicates that there's close to 250,000 cases in this country of individuals with Alzheimer's disease under the age of 65. On Long Island, in my chapter right now, I have just about 40 cases, which is double what we had last year. But still, no real scientific evidence as to why all of this is happening. Do we suspect things? Yes. But real scientific evidence, no.
So just for my own personal well-being, what are the chances that I will have Alzheimer's someday?
Again, another difficult question because there is no real scientific data that can tell you at this point who is going to get this and who's not going to get this. We do suspect that there's genetics involved. We do know that if there is a family history, such as the Henley family, we had a mom, a brother, and another brother impacted by Alzheimer's disease. Those are strong predictors that we may see it in the family. But then we have other cases in the office where there's absolutely none in the family, and we're looking at an early onset case. So it's a very difficult situation right now.
So we just don't know. I want to ask you about something you've told me before, which is Alzheimer's is not just about memory loss. Talk to us about that.
That was everyone's preconceived notion. Hmm. Alzheimer's was just a problem with memory. Hmm. You know, mom's getting older, dad's getting older, they have a little problem with memory. What people don't realize is that it is actually a disease process. It is fatal. It is the seventh leading killer in this country. It spans over a period of time. Many changes occur over those time frames, and families need an enormous amount of support to help them get through this.
Hmm.
Doctor, you know, listening to these statistics, a couple of questions come to mind. First of all, you know, with an older population, we did say, well, you know, grandma's getting older. And is there a difference between dementia and Alzheimer's?
Well, that's a good question. I think people traditionally felt that Alzheimer's was a very severe form of dementia, and just having dementia was perhaps a milder form of the disease. Today we know that Alzheimer's disease is the most common form of dementia. And as a matter of fact, when it was first described, it was described at the turn of the century in the early 1900s in a young person.
Mm-hmm.
Subsequently, we've learned that it is the most common form of dementia in older people.
Now,
while it's shocking to see this syndrome in younger people, it's not particularly surprising. We don't know if the incidence of this is increasing or, in fact, the population is getting larger as a whole, the elderly population in particular, and so we're getting better at recognizing the disease and making the diagnosis.
Yes. And still no understanding as to the cause or the cause of early onset.
Well, early onset does have a strong genetic predisposition, as Mary Ann mentioned, but what the exact genetic deficit is or why it exists, I don't have an answer to that.
Mm-hmm. Is it understood that early onset Alzheimer is typically genetic primarily, or are there cases where there's no history in the family that one is aware of?
It would depend on just how early you define early onset. I mean, it's an arbitrary distinction. I mean, you're, at the age of 65, you're considered old. At the age of 64, you're considered not old. But so how early is early? But the earliest ones, the cases as being described today, clearly have a much higher genetic predisposition and prevalence in history to go along with it, as opposed to the people who are developing at the age of 65, 75, 85.
Can we do anything to prevent this?
Prevention requires us to understand what causes the disease process. There are lots of associations and some ways, and perhaps one can maintain cognitive function through successful aging. But the word prevention, in terms of having a vaccine or knowing something in particular to identify someone who might be at risk and prevent the disease from emerging, we don't have that currently. What we do have are therapies, both pharmacologic and non-pharmacologic, which help to manage some of the manifestations of the disease process.
It sounds like then we need a lot of research that has to be done, because we're at the early stages and we've got all these boomers who are also going to be aging. Marianne, research, talk to us about that.
Research is ongoing, but research is definitely an issue right now. It's in danger of being slowed down because we can't get the necessary funding to do the research that's needed to try to get to the bottom of some of these issues. We had a great amount of movement in the research world over the past several years, and then I'd say about 2 years ago, we began to cut funding at the federal level. And when we started to cut funding, obviously we started to cut the types of projects that we were doing at the NIA. We continue as an organization to fund private research projects, and we actually heard from a researcher over the weekend who's doing some interesting work with the protein that they believe has some connection to Alzheimer's disease. But it's going to take years, unfortunately. These things don't happen overnight.
As a society, we all need to focus in, because we have a crisis on our hands, and we really need to make sure we're putting those dollars into the research for our well-being, as you know, we're all going to be affected one way or another, whether we come down with the disease or whether we're a caregiver for someone with the disease. I want to thank both of you so much for joining us today on Family Comes First. So much appreciation I have for all the good work that you're doing. For more information on the Alzheimer's Association Long Island chapter, you can go to their website at www.alz.org/Long Island. When we come back, we will meet with the Henley family. Stay with us.
We first noticed Mike was having problems, I guess it was in the summer of 2000. We were away on vacation and he forgot where my daughter was. Usually people, you know, they forget where the keys or, you know, where they walked into a room for, but we made extensive plans with another family to break up and go to different places, and in the middle of our part of the trip with my son, he looked at me and said, "Where is Courtney anyway?" So at that point, I knew that there was going to be a problem. I made an appointment right away with his family doctor. And my biggest concern actually was, because of my husband's age, which was 36, that the doctor wasn't going to take my concern seriously. But he did take him very seriously. And he sent us for extensive testing. And after 2 or 3 days of the neuropsych testing, the doctor pulled me aside and she said, this is definitely Alzheimer's disease. So he was officially diagnosed with early onset Alzheimer's at the age of 36 in April of 2001. It was a really difficult time in our lives because I knew he had a problem, but he was very, part of the disease is that people become very, they just don't care about anything. They're very laid back. There was no concern about the house, the kids, and I was dealing with a husband who was just diagnosed, 2 young children. My children were 7 and 9 when they were diagnosed, and he just didn't seem to care. I knew he was sick, but at the same time, you know, I had a house to run, I had children to take care of, and it was a very, very frustrating time for me. The Alzheimer's that my husband has is called familial dementia, familial Alzheimer's dementia. It runs in families. His mom was diagnosed at the age of 45. She passed away when she was 52. His brother was diagnosed when he was 41, and he passed away at the age of 43. So part of the reasons that I do what I do in speaking out is that each of my children have a 50-50 chance of inheriting the gene that causes this disease. My husband has been home from the day of diagnosis until present. It's one of the things we're striving to do to keep him at home. It's been extremely difficult keeping him at home, emotionally, physically, financially. But it's where I think he belongs. When he was first diagnosed, the doctors had given us a 5 to 7 year window of the time that he would have. He's on 9 years now, and every single one of them has said it's because of the care he gets at home, where he is with the family around him. I wouldn't trade it for the world. Right now, my husband is on hospice. He's been on hospice for about 1.5, 2 years now. He requires 24/7 care. He can no longer talk. He can't walk, he can't feed himself. It's like taking care of an infant, to be honest with you. He requires total care at this point in time. Some of the biggest challenges that I face every day is the unpredictability. The disease is unpredictable. My husband could be fine 1 minute, the next he could have a fever. One day he woke up, he was fine. The next day he woke up with a punctured lung. We had to rush him to the hospital. My strength 100% is my faith. If people ask me all the time, if I did not have my faith, I don't know where I would be to this day. I mean, my motto is the footprints poem. I have it everywhere in my house. It's on my ring, it's on my necklace. I have blankets and posters. I mean, because that is honestly and truthfully what gets me through every single day. I wake up and pray to God for the strength to get through another day.
Welcome back to Family Comes First. Today we are talking about Alzheimer's disease and how it affects the family.
We are now joined by the Henley family, Karen, Courtney, and Brandon. Thank you all for being here today. I cannot say enough about my belief that you are such a loving and caring family and going through such challenges. So I really appreciate that you are willing to be on the show today.
Oh, sure.
Truly, thank you so much. I'm going to start, Karen, with the challenges you face today. Taking care of Mike, your husband, working, and being there for your children. How do you do it? What are your concerns?
It's really difficult. I'm not going to lie. It's sure. Very hard working full time. Mm-hmm. One of the concerns I have at this point in time is I always worry that I'm taking too much time away from the children to take care of my husband. I'm always on the fence, like maybe I should be spending more time with them, doing more things with them. That's a big concern for me. Mm-hmm. And now that we're 9 years into this disease and, you know, we've run the gamut with, you know, the different stages and not being able to talk, walk, the anger, the agitation. Honestly, right now, our biggest concern is financial. It's a very, very difficult thing.
Are you receiving any financial support, government benefits, for example? Are they helping you, like Medicaid? Is that available?
Well, yeah. I mean, Medicaid, my husband's been on Medicaid since he's been, you know, since he was diagnosed. Thankfully, in a odd sense, his mom had been diagnosed with this. Mm-hmm. So we knew basically what we had to do when he was diagnosed. So we got everything in place for that. But it's difficult. I mean, he gets aides at home, but, you know, they don't come. You know, it's very hard. It's hard keeping it at home. We've had to fight tooth and nail for everything we have.
You guys have been so there for your mom. You know, what's it like? What's it like to have experienced this from being real little?
It is difficult because we don't really know what could have been
sure.
or what we could have done or how it would be different this is what we know, what our lives have been. Mm-hmm. So it's really difficult.
So it is the reality.
Yeah.
And but yet you have friends, and you see your friends' lives are different.
You know, we go out with our friends just like anybody our age would, and it's just a little bit, like, but they don't understand sometimes is the amount of planning that has to go into going to things, because I know my friends just like, oh, let's go somewhere tonight, and I'm like, well, I wish I would have known about this a couple of days ago, because then we could have coordinated rides, and if the aide is not there or had to leave, if we can't have, you know, get to somewhere, we have to help out at home. So it's kind of like the spontaneity isn't there, mm-hmm. like all my friends have, but otherwise, you know, we get to see them.
Courtney, you have become sort of a resource for your friends.
Yeah.
You were telling us.
One of my friends has a family member that was just diagnosed with it, and there, you know, there's a lot of questions that come up when the diagnosis is first there, mm-hmm. and she was asking me about things that happened with my dad, and, you know, just to kind of get comfort that the same things are happening with her grandma, and just to know that this is sort of just how the progression goes. And if she has questions or anything, like, she knows she can come to me because I've been through it, mm-hmm. so I can give her a better answer than somebody who has no idea what's going on. So it's nice to know that she feels comfortable asking, because a lot of kids would be a little put off by that.
Yeah, I think a lot of those kids are unfortunately going to have, if not already, have grandparents.
Yeah.
And especially those grandparents who are over the age of 85. There are over 5 million people in America with Alzheimer's.
Mm-hmm. Even recently, in the Times, there was an article about a family in Colombia.
Yeah, that just solidified to me the how huge of an issue this is. Yeah. It was a woman who was caring, her husband had passed away from Alzheimer's, and she was caring for four out of five of her children who developed early onset Alzheimer's. They all developed it in their 40s. And so here is this woman in Colombia caring for her four children. And what really struck me is this one man's son had a son and daughter, and they looked like Courtney and Brandon's age. Oh. And the young boy was feeding his dad. The daughter was holding the father's hand. And I'm like, that could be Mike with Courtney and Brandon. You know, it transcends all cultures, ages, everything. And it's just horrific. It's just a horrific disease, and it really needs to end.
Well, and you're doing so much.
Yes.
All of you really have been so generous with your time and with your personal life and sharing it to create awareness.
Yeah. You've become an advocate. I know this.
Yeah.
I've heard you speak to healthcare professionals and other families similarly situated. You've become a true advocate. Why is that important to you?
Oh, it's a huge thing for me. I mean, first and foremost, it's for them. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm a mother who has two children who are, you know, they're in a danger of getting this disease. So I do it to fight for their future, to make sure that, you know, this disease is cured. That years ago, AIDS was a huge disease. You got the disease, you died from it. You know, people started voicing their opinion in Washington. Money started coming in for research, and now people can survive with AIDS. And that's what I would love for Alzheimer's. And the second part of that is, you know, Alzheimer's, there are no survivors of Alzheimer's.
Right.
Alzheimer's patients, they don't have a voice. Very soon into this disease, they lose their voice. They don't understand them. They don't speak. You know, someone needs to speak up for them. You know, I do it in honor of my husband. He doesn't deserve this. He's lost out on their whole life growing up. Mm-hmm. And, you know, someone needs to speak up for them. And I feel that that's what I could do. It's one of the few things that I can do. My whole thing for years has been, I don't think enough research goes into it because they feel it's an old person's disease. Mm-hmm. They've lived their life. It's a sad situation. But, you know, what can we do? But more and more younger families are dealing with this disease. And that's one of the first things I told them. Research. We definitely need research, and we need funding for keeping the patient at home. I mean, I like I said, I'm fighting tooth and nail for the services for my husband.
let's talk a little about here on Long Island, the Alzheimer's Association Long Island chapter.
Yes.
And there are chapters all over the country.
Yes.
But your experience seeking help and support from the local chapter?
I mean, they've just been a phenomenal source of information and help. Recently, when we tried to get to Washington, they were helping me look for respite care for him. You know, they've just been there. You could call them up for anything, and they're there for you. And
thank goodness.
Yeah. I mean, one of the things they just recently did at the luncheon that I spoke at, they developed the Mike Henley Advocate of the Year Award.
Yes.
In honor of my husband, so that each year they'll give it to somebody, they'll present it to somebody who was a deserving advocate for this disease. And to me, that means the world.
And we wish you all the best.
Thank you
for being here.
Thank you.
And now we turn to Monsignor McNamara for a spiritual reflection.
Karen has great strength as she speaks about her husband Mike and his struggle with Alzheimer's disease. How she is able to care for him each day is amazing and I think edifying. This terrible disease took his mother and brother at an early age, and now it is ravaging his body. In addition, she is concerned whether or not her children could inherit this disease. I think that's quite a burden. How does she do it? Well, she herself gives tremendous witness, as we see. Her witness is a homily worth hearing and an example worth imitating. She takes each day at a time, and she finds strength in her faith. Instead of pushing God away by asking, why me, she allows God to be her rock of refuge. In light of her struggles, what could I possibly complain about today?
For more information on resources regarding Alzheimer's disease, and for the legal planning to preserve one's dignity and protect assets, please visit www.alz.org/Long Island or your firm, Vincent.
Thank you.
www.vjrussolaw.com.
I would just like to add that the Alzheimer's Association Long Island chapter has a legal advisory committee. Mm. So please call the association for help at 631-580-5100.
Today we have learned an important lesson: that we must do our best to combat this horrible disease, and we can find hope and strength from family and resources that are available in our community.
Well said, Victoria. Thanks to all our viewers for joining us today, and remember, family truly does come first.